Hello everyone and welcome to MediSimplified. So today we are going to discuss another important topic from the pharynx, and that is the nasopharyngeal carcinoma or nasopharyngeal cancer. So let's begin. Okay, the topic for today is nasopharyngeal carcinoma. I will be abbreviating it as NPC. So first of all, what we should know about nasopharyngeal carcinoma is that where does it originate from, right? So the origin of this cancer is from fossa of Rosenmüller, right? So fossa of Rosenmüller. Then next thing is, this is a common question asked in many exams, so it is important to remember. Then where this disease is most common or more common, right? So it is most common in South China, right? So it is most common in South China. Okay. Now next thing is, where in South, there is a province in South China that is known as Guangdong. So Guangdong province. In the South China, also in Guangdong province, this NPC is the most common, right? Most commonly seen. So that's why this nasopharyngeal carcinoma is also known as Guangdong's cancer. Also known as Guangdong carcinoma. Right. So now in India, where we can see this cancer or this disease. In India, it is not common, right? So in India, not common. But it can be seen in some of the northeastern states. The population of the northeastern states may show some patient of this nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So why the reason for this is that this disease is more common in Mongols, right? Or Mongolians or Mongoloids, this community, right? So few of the northeast people are of Mongolians. So it is can be seen in India also in the northeastern state. So this was about the epidemiology per se of this disease. Now let's talk about the etiology of this disease, right? So this disease is a multifactorial disease. So first, what we should now let's divide this etiology in part by part, right? So first we'll talk about the genetic of this disease. Not genetic, that it is a genetical or hereditary disease. So it runs in the families. And all the member of the family should be screened and shall be screened for this nasopharyngeal carcinoma. If any one person has been suffered this nasopharyngeal carcinoma in previous days or in previous generation, right? So if all the members should be screened for this NPC, if any family history is present. Second is viral, right? So one virus which is responsible for nasopharyngeal carcinoma is EBV. We all know it very well. So the Epstein-Barr virus. So for screening this disease, we do screening of two important antigens. Okay. So for screening nasopharyngeal carcinoma, we check the two important antigens. One is the capsid antigen, and another is early antigen. So early antigen, it is abbreviated as EA, whereas capsid antigen, which is denoted or abbreviated as IgA, it is the IgA antigen, and it is known as VCA, that is viral capsid antigen. So VCA, viral capsid antigen. So this was about genetic, that it runs in the hereditary. It is a hereditary disease and it is commonly caused by the Epstein-Barr virus. Now talking about the environmental factors of this disease. Okay, so environmental factors like air pollution, smoking of tobacco, they can cause this nasopharyngeal carcinoma, right? And another one important thing which we should remember, which is responsible for NPC, is nitrosamines. So what we should remember, nitrosamines. Now, what is this nitrosamine? It is used as a preservative, right? It is used as a preservatives. Where we use it, it is used as a preservative in dried fish or that kind of stuff, etc. So this was totally about this etiology, right? That is genetic. Then I talked about the viruses and then I told you about the environmental factor. Now we'll talk about the pathological classification of this tumor, which was given by WHO in 2005. So this classification is based on light microscopy finding. So three histological type one, that is keratinizing squamous cell carcinoma, type 2A, that is non-keratinizing differentiated carcinoma, and type 2B, that is non-keratinizing undifferentiated carcinoma. I'll remove this red highlight. One second. Differentiated is type 2A and undifferentiated is type 2B. And then at last, the third is the basaloid squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, basaloid squamous cell carcinoma. So these are the three types of the histological type. Type 1, it is keratinizing. Type 2 is non-keratinizing. And type 3 is basaloid. And 2 is divided into 2A and 2B. That is differentiated and undifferentiated. Now this tumor, it grows basically in three form. It is of three form, right? It is of three form. So first is proliferative form. Okay. Second is ulcerative form and third is infiltrative form. Okay, so the first form is proliferative form. What does the proliferative form do? It is a polypoid tumor. The form is polypoid and it is this polypoid tumor fills the nasopharynx. Okay, it fills the nasopharynx and it causes nasal obstructions and related symptoms. Okay, next is ulcerative type. It is usually the type which bleeds from the nose and this is known as epistaxis, the nasal bleed. So it usually bleeds and presents as epistaxis. Next is infiltrative type and it is grossly. It grows and it is infiltrating the which layer? That it infiltrates the submucosal layer. So infiltrates submucosally. And how do we know this, which form of the tumor it is, right? Whether it is proliferative, it is ulcerative or infiltrative, we do biopsy of this tumor. We do biopsy of the growth. The extra growth and we can find that it is a nasopharyngeal carcinoma and it is of which type. So now let's talk about clinical features. Male is to female ratio is 3:1. That is males are three times more having more incidence than female. It is common in elderly and more specific that the age group of 50s and 70s. So it does not mean that it cannot be seen in young adults, right? So it can be seen in young patients too. Now, this was the common clinical feature. Now the thing is, there are few nasal symptoms and few otological symptoms, right? So first we'll talk about nasal symptom. Nasal symptoms, I told you, one was obstruction due to polypoid growth, epistaxis due to ulcerative, right? And there can be discharge or there can be a case called as rhinolalia clausa. So rhinolalia clausa. This was about the nasal symptom. Now otologic symptom. Let me try to explain you. Suppose this is a ear and in the middle ear cavity there is a Eustachian tube. If you go further, I'm not drawing the middle ear perfectly, and this is a nasopharynx, suppose. So if this tumor grows from the nasopharynx and it goes into the Eustachian tube, it will cause an obstruction, right? So if this Eustachian tube obstruction occurs, this will cause the pathology, if it is in the middle ear, so it will cause a hearing loss, that is conductive hearing loss, and then otitis media can be seen of serous or superative type. Eustachian tube obstruction will be causing conductive hearing loss. To know more about types of hearing loss, please watch this video which is coming over here, right? If now one more thing, suppose we are in a OPD, if an elderly patient comes, right, and with a unilateral serous otitis media, plus he is having conductive hearing loss, right? So what will we, not just it can be or also, but we, if such condition comes to you, just try to think about nasopharyngeal carcinoma, right? And one more thing, in 70% of the patients, the first symptom is upper deep cervical lymph node swelling, right? So in 70% of the patients, upper deep cervical lymph node swelling is the first symptom which is seen. If an elderly patient comes to you with unilateral serous otitis media or unilateral conductive hearing loss at the age of 70, please think of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Now let's talk about the growth of this tumor, okay? Suppose this is the tumor present, okay, NPC here, right? And so the tumor may grow superiorly and it may go laterally. So we'll talk about if it goes superiorly, what will happen. If the tumor goes superiorly, it can extend in many other ways, but I am talking about two important way of growth, its growth. So if it grows superiorly, it can cause intracranial, it can go into intracranial cavity and it can go to sinus of Morgagni, right? So what I want to discuss with you of more, which is of more important, is if the tumor goes into the sinus of Morgagni, what will happen if it goes into the sinus of Morgagni, right? If the NPC goes into sinus of Morgagni, what will happen? There will be neuralgia, fifth cranial nerve, right? There will be palatal palsy for P, and there can be conductive hearing loss, C for conductive hearing loss, right? So if the tumor goes into sinus of Morgagni, the NPC goes to sinus of Morgagni, it will cause neuralgia, palatal palsy, and CHL, and this is known as the Trotter's triad. This is known as Trotter's triad. How to remember? Neuralgia, NPC, neuralgia, P for palatal palsy, C for conductive hearing loss. And this Trotter's triad is also known as sinus of Morgagni syndrome, as it is caused when the tumor is growing till the sinus of Morgagni, right? So this was if the tumor grows superiorly, going into sinus of Morgagni, causes NPC and Trotter's triad. Now, if it goes laterally, what will happen? If it goes laterally, so it can go to the parapharyngeal space. Right? There is a space in the pharynx known as parapharyngeal space. So if it goes there, it can affect or involve the fourth cranial nerve, that is 9, 10, 11, and 12. And this may lead to Horner's syndrome. Right, so two important things which we should remember: if it goes superiorly, it will cause Trotter's triad. If it goes laterally, it will cause Horner's syndrome. Now, how will we diagnose this disease? We do diagnosis by usually doing three things. First, we do endoscopy, right? We do imaging, right? It can be CT or MRI of the nasopharynx and neck. Also, we did earlier on, I already told you that we do biopsy to know the growth, which kind of growth it is, right? Which kind of tumor it is. It is proliferative, it is infiltrative, or it is ulcerative. So to know the form of tumor, whether it is proliferative, ulcerative, or third, infiltrative. All right. Now let's go further. After this diagnosis, a very simple thing which is left, that is the management. It is not simple, but theoretically it is very simple to say. We will divide this cancer into stage 1, 2, 3, 4, right? For stage 1 and 2, we have a similar kind of treatment, and stage 3 and 4, we have a similar kind of treatment to remember it easily, right? So remember that stage 1 and 2, what we do only radiotherapy, that is RT radiotherapy. Whereas for stage 3 and 4, what we do radiotherapy and chemotherapy in cycles, in different cycles. So yes, that was everything about the nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Let's have a quick review what we decide, what we discussed right now, because it was a bit of haphazard, I think, in between. So let's start from the beginning. Okay, so nasopharyngeal carcinoma originates from the fossa of Rosenmüller. Most commonly, it's seen in the Guangdong province of China and common in Mongolians, right? Etiological factor, genetics, right? Viral, it is caused by Epstein-Barr virus. It is important to remember. Then in Epstein-Barr virus, two important antigens which we check usually, that is early antigen and viral capsid antigen, air pollution, smoking of tobacco. More important was nitrosamine, which was used as preservatives. Tumor grossly grows in three forms, that is proliferative, ulcerative, and infiltrative. Then we talked about the pathological classification based on the microscopy, type 1 keratinizing, type 2 was non-keratinizing, in which A was differentiated, B was undifferentiated, type 3 was basaloid squamous cell carcinoma. Then the clinical feature, male issue, female ratio was 3:1. Nasal symptoms I discussed. What was more important? It was the otological symptoms, that is eustachian tube obstruction and otitis media, which can be serous or suppurative type. Due to eustachian tube obstruction, we had a conductive hearing loss. And if an elderly patient comes with a unilateral serous otitis media or conductive hearing loss, we should think of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. The first symptom was upper deep cervical lymph node swelling. Now, if the tumor grows, if the tumor grows superiorly, it is important to know that it can go to sinus of Morgagni and we can see Trotter stair. If it goes laterally, we can see Horner's syndrome. Diagnosis is done by endoscopy. Stage 1 and 2, we do radiotherapy, whereas for stage 3 and 4, we do radio and chemotherapy in different cycles. So thanks for watching the video. This was all about nasopharyngeal carcinoma I had to discuss with you. Hope you find this video useful. Please do like, share, and subscribe my channel, MediSimplified. Thank you.